Well, she had culturally responsible teaching is an idea, an ideal, a mindset to which we all aspire to cultivate, right? And this week is such an exceptional one because we have the opportunity to turn over that idea, to interrogate, to explore it deeply. I am so deeply pleased that I can present to you Dr. Klein McKoy, day three of our residency.
Good morning. Yeah, I come from a place where when you say good morning, you have to say good morning back, so I'm telling you. I want to start out and apologize to the folks on this side for being mostly on this side, because this is where my remote will hit my laptop, so I feel like I need to be over here, but I will do my best to make sure that I cover the whole room as I speak. The purpose of this presentation really is to kind of delve into some aspects of culturally responsive teaching that deal with the approaches we take in working with students in our courses. This particular topic of honoring the ear, for me, is critically important because it has to do with a couple of things that relate to the ways in which we approach teaching music. One of which is acknowledging that there are lots of cultures in the world and microcultures in the United States where the dissemination of music has nothing to do with notes on a printed page. And the second idea is that if indeed we are engaging in music as an oral art, we actually owe it to our students to help them develop those oral capacities that are significant and important to an oral art. So in my presentation to you today, I'm going to talk at you for a little bit, but soon thereafter we'll be engaging in some activities that I hope will sort of demonstrate the ideas that I'm going to pose and challenge you with today. So getting more specific, today we're going to look at some of the misperceptions about oral learning that we might have, especially in formal learning contexts, and by that I mean in our classrooms and our rehearsal spaces. We're going to look at how we might promote oral learning as a critical facet of our instruction, to include some strategies that incorporate oral learning and recognize that that's a way of learning that is familiar to many of the students that we'll teach. And then finally, we're going to explore how oral learning can be used effectively in understanding culturally diverse facets of musicianship and literacy. This last part I think is really critical too, because when we talk about music literacy, we tend to think of it in terms of teaching people how to decode notation, how to read notation. And indeed, that's an important part of our job as music educators. But we have some issues that relate to that that I'm going to talk about in just a minute. If you review perceptions or philosophies of music education, one of the terms you might run across a lot is rote to note or sound before symbol. And those terms imply that before we have students learn to read music notation, it's important for them to develop their oral capacities, that they experience music orally. And indeed, everybody in here engaged with music orally initially as young people. That kind of goes without saying. And there are some significant reasons for that. There are researchers who make some comparisons between the development of music understandings and the development of language. Researchers say that students or children who read more are children who were read to more. Research also encourages parents not to talk to their kids in baby talk. but to speak to them in complete sentences, because that's the way that kids begin to learn the processes and the syntax and the principles of language, so that they can learn how to speak in the particular language that is familiar to them and that is a part of their culture. And so they make those comparisons to music, that it's really important for children to have all experiences with whatever music is part of their culture or is part of the musical system of their culture, so that they can learn the principles of that system or that genre, so they can, if you will, understand the musical syntax, how it functions and how it works. They need to be exposed to it orally, a lot. And so we say that that's what we do. But I question whether we really do that. And that's kind of part of what we're going to talk about today, or what I'm going to talk about with you today. One of the reasons why we don't tend to do that sometimes as much as we claim that we do has to do with some issues related to limited instructional time. How much time do general music teachers typically have here? Like 45 minutes, once a week? It depends, doesn't it? In some places it's once a week, in some places, in North Carolina, I know that it can run anywhere from 30 minutes once a week to 40 minutes once a week to 45 minutes every 6 weeks, because there are schools that are on a 6-day rotation, right? There are some schools where they see the same class 2 days in a row and then they don't see them again for another 6 weeks. So it varies. And generally speaking, if there are 180 days in a school year, that works out to be about 990 hours. And my understanding is if you broke those down into continuous teaching days, you would get 40 days. If we started on day one and just continued to teach all the way, you get about 40 days. Well, as far as general music is concerned, that's, we get only 3% of that. So that's like 27 hours, which is a little over a day. That's the extent of music instruction that elementary age kids tend to get. And that's if you have a schedule where you meet the kids once a week. And I just talked about ones where they don't meet quite that often. So limited instructional time means that general music teachers may feel that they don't have a lot of time in which to teach kids to read music. So they may feel that push or that that pressure to introduce music notation to students before they're quite ready for it, because they know they don't have a lot of time. So that's one of the issues. Another issue is pressure from colleagues to introduce notation to students. And sometimes this pressure comes from colleagues who teach ensembles. They feel that it's the general music teacher's responsibility to make sure that when kids get to the age where they can join an ensemble, and that age can differ. When I was teaching in public school back when dinosaurs roamed the earth, in one of my schools, kids could join the orchestra in fourth grade, and then they could join the band in sixth grade, and they could join the choir. I had actually choirs at several levels. But because typically the expectation is that if students join an instrumental ensemble, they're going to need to read, general music teachers were expected to get the kids ready to read, at least simple notation, before they had the opportunity to join these ensembles. And, you know, the pressure is at varying degrees depending on the colleague. Some colleagues are like, you better have them ready. That's my expectation for you. That's really the only reason you're here. Other colleagues, of course, don't express that expectation in those ways. But they certainly feel like if the kids do know notation when they get to them, that's a benefit. So then there's that. But one of the biggest issues is our subscription to the paradigm of notational centricity. What does that mean? It means that we believe that people aren't truly musicians unless they know how to read music. Not only that, But music educators are kind of notorious for promoting this notion that what's on the page is what's primary, even if it's an oral art. And so that creates a lot of problems for us. And we have to be really, really careful about it. There are some researchers that say that this notion of the supremacy of notation can decrease oral sensitivity for the natural patterns that children spontaneously perceive if they engage with music orally. And it becomes a little bit difficult for them. A researcher named Woody says that learning by ear is dismissed as simplistic and an ineffective alternative to note reading. I will say that when I was in college, this is really interesting to share. Most people, if they see me, if someone were to ask you if I grew up experiencing gospel music, they'd probably assume I did, but I didn't. We had a gospel choir in my church, but my mother was not particularly happy with them. It wasn't the music that appealed to her a whole lot. I actually liked it, but we didn't talk about it a whole lot. When I went to college, that was actually my first experience with contemporary gospel music because they had a choir of students, and you see this everywhere now, but this was, like I said, back when dinosaurs roamed around. This was not usual. It was not customary. And they had a group called the Oberlin Black Ensemble. It was made of student members. They had student directors, but they had a faculty advisor. And they were doing a lot of contemporary gospel music, and that was my first experience with it. So I went to my first rehearsal, right? And the student director started conducting the rehearsals, as you do, completely orally. And I was intrigued by the sound, but I was like, give me a piece of music, because I can read like a mother. Just give me some music and I'll be all right. I was not patient with the process of learning orally. And so I was very impatient about it until I realized the benefits I would get from learning orally. And also understanding that there, at least at the time, is a particular pattern to a lot of gospel music. And if I understood the pattern, then I could begin to pick it up. And I was also very impressed by the vocal improvisational skills of the students that I was singing with. All of this because of the oral transmission of the music. But when I think back, the reason I share this with you is I think back when I say, you know, I was influenced by this notational centricity. Otherwise, I would have never said, give me a piece of music, give me a score, where the score at? I would have never asked for that because I would have understood that that's not what's needed or necessary in this particular form of music making. But I have been trained in a particular way, and oftentimes when we're trained in a particular way, we behave in particular ways because of that training. There are other reasons why having a narrow definition of music literacy, that is, only associating it with reading of music, can be really problematic for us. First of all, there are many models of music making in which notation doesn't play a part. And I think that's we can understand that. There are lots of cultures around the world, and as I say, microcultures in the U.S., and the example I just gave, where, you know, having notation is not a part of the learning process. And it doesn't inhibit the music making, and in many cases enhances it. So that means that maybe we should expand our idea of what music literacy is. Second of all, many researchers say that no child needs to be able to decode staff notation before learning to make the sorts of music where staff notation is typically customarily used. Too often we make an assumption that if a piece of music has notation, we have to use that notation with our students, that we have to do it. And sometimes, probably more often than we want to admit, notation becomes a barrier to our students. Now, if a student is having problems reading, rather than maybe backing up and saying, okay, well, how might I accommodate or revise my teaching in such a way that I can make use of my students' oral skills, which might be stronger at this particular point than their music reading skills? No, we push the reading. We're gonna make that child read. We're gonna help them read, rather than looking at what they bring to the table and utilizing that for the music making. So that's one of the problems that we encounter. And then learning to read music before we learn to really make music well can lead to some misunderstandings. I want to share some ideas about some of these misunderstandings with you. I've got a picture of three different instruments here. And before I talk about what these pictures mean, if you think about how we use the terms high and low for pitch, those are only associated with what we see on the page. High pitches are on the higher part of the staff, low pitches are on the lower part of the staff. So acoustically speaking, if you take a course in acoustics, they don't talk about the descriptions of high and low are not, the descriptions are not given in that way. It has to do with waveforms, what the waveforms look like. But in this particular slide, what we see is that where high pitches and low pitches are on different instruments are in different places. If you're teaching a child to play a keyboard, high is on the right side of the keyboard, and low is on, high is on the right side of the keyboard and low is on the left side. But if you're teaching a child to play a guitar, the highest string is at the bottom of the series of strings, and the lowest string is at the top of the series of strings. If a child is playing a string bass or a cello, when we ask them to make or to play a higher pitch, where does their hand go? It goes down. To play a higher pitch. And so you can see that for some, or at least I hope you can see that for some students, trying to negotiate those directional differences among the instruments and correlate that with this perception of high and low can be problematic if they're reading notation on the staff. If they're not, if they're dealing with things orally, we can still talk about high and low pitches, but it's not a matter of trying to correlate what they see on the page, high and low, with what they're doing with their hands. So this focus on notation too early can create problems for some students in terms of their perception. There's something else about our notational centricity that's problematic. It's problematic because a lot of our strategies that we use to teach are based not on what things sound like, but what they look like in a score. This is a really good example of this. If you would, I'm going to count off, and would you clap just that top line for me, please? One, two, ready, and. Okay. A youngster was given the opportunity to hear the pattern that you just clapped and was asked to recreate that pattern in their own way. And I really like this drawing because the child decided to draw puppy faces. I'm going to say those are puppy faces. I really don't know what they are, but they look like puppy faces to me. And they drew 10 puppy faces because there are 10 sounds, right? Can somebody explain, based on the puppy faces and these arrows and the word fast, what was the child trying to communicate about what they heard? Try to decipher that, if you would. Yes, sir. Yeah, I mean, that's actually, if you think about it, it's pretty cool. The student indicated in their own way what it was that they were hearing. But what's interesting for us as musicians We can understand why they say the second and the third was fast, but they also said that was fast. Why did they say that? Why did they say that third sound was fast? Yes?
To them, it sounded like it was a group fast and maybe rest, because they assumed that it was a quarter note implementation.
Yeah. They're going by what they heard. What they heard was this. And yet, when we teach about rhythm, and we really want to focus on rhythm, we usually have students clap. But clapping is like the worst way to deal with rhythm. I mean, it's okay if you're dealing with 16th notes or maybe even 8th notes all the time. But what happens when you have a half note? When I was coming through as a music, studying to be a music teacher, this is what they taught me to do. Let's imagine that instead of having two quarter notes here, it's quarter, eighth, eighth, half. This is what I was taught to do. Here's why we were taught to do that. When you are clapping or using any percussion, certain percussion instruments, all you have is the onset. You don't have duration. It doesn't resound. Clapping, you can't do that with clapping. And so instead of finding a different way to have students execute rhythm so that it corresponds to the sounds they're hearing, we just do it visually. It makes no sense to me. And I did it for a long time because that's the way I was trained to do it until someone told me, you know what? Maybe you should pick a pitch. Stay on that pitch since you're focusing on rhythm and not on the difference of pitches, and then you can sustain it. So instead of going, I can sing, la, 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 la. So that what students hear corresponds with what they're being asked to decode. So this is really, to me, a good example of how we've allowed the visual to interfere with how we present information to our students. Because in this case, the visual doesn't correspond with what the students are hearing as they clap, right? So if you want students to hear this accurately, we need to present it to them in accurate ways. So this is another problem that we have when we don't think carefully about how the visual translates into the aural. Couple of other things, and then we're going to get to the
audience participation part.
Too early an exposure to staff notation can lead people to overlook the features of music that are not its focus. So for instance, features like dynamics, timbre, articulation, and tempo. We can present these on a score, but we seldom attend to them while teaching students to decode notation. We just focus so much on having them get the rhythm right or whatever that we lose some of the other things. And it also limits students' focus only to what's presented on the staff, which tells them basically which notes from the Western classical scale to play, when the note should start, when the next note should start, if the tempo is constant. And undue emphasis on staff notation leads to the atrophy of musicians' creative abilities and their ability to memorize. I had a situation where I was doing an activity with my general music methods class that involved the use of barred instruments. If you know anything about barred instruments, you know that you can remove the bars and set them up in pentatonic mode, and that's a great mode to work in for improvisation. So I was doing this with my class, and we were singing a song, and I decided to set the form in ABA. So in the A section, we'd sing the song. The B section, we'd do an instrumental interlude that was improvised, and in the A section, we'd sing the song again. And I showed them how I wanted them to do it. I said, I'm going to give you 16 counts to improvise. And on that 16th count, just play the tonic note. So we'd have a feeling of finale. So we sang the song. We got to the B section. I had demonstrated what I wanted them to do. So they were ready to go. We got to the B section. Everybody started improvising, doing what they wanted. And there was one girl in the class who was standing by her barred instrument with her mallets in the air. And she wasn't playing. And so I noticed her as I was walking around, and I didn't make a big deal about it. I got close to her, and I said, you know, you can just start praying anytime that matters. It's not going to matter. And so she just stood there. And so we sang the song again, because I figured she was probably just thinking about what she wanted to play. So we sang the song again, got to the B section. She was still like this, with her mouths. And I noticed she was starting to turn red. She was having a problem. And so I decided not to draw attention to her again. I think I tried one more time. I said, well, don't worry. It's going to be okay. You can't make a mistake. Just play whatever you want to play. And she would not. She did not. And so I went on. I said, well, I'm not going to draw attention to her again. But later on afterwards, I met her in the hallway. And I needed to know what the issue was, because I wanted to see if I could help her. And I said, what was happening? What's going on with you? She says, I have never had the experience of making something up, and I was afraid of making a mistake. She was a piano principal, and all she had ever done was read from notation. She had never been asked to make anything up on the keyboard or to improvise. And I could understand she'd never, you know, been asked to improvise, but she had such little experience with that, that when she had the opportunity to do it, she could not. She could not bring herself to just play and be free to play. And I thought, oh, how sad for her that she never had that capacity. I'm here to tell you, second graders don't have that problem. If you place a barred instrument in front of them, set in pentatonic mode, and you show them what the framework is for improvisation, they'll play all over the place, just with complete abandon. But that experience made me think, wow, this is an example and anybody else would probably say she was a great pianist, no doubt. But that's one aspect of her musicianship that was lacking. And the fact that she could not bring herself to even just play on a barred instrument, you know, that really brought into high relief for me this notion of the importance of giving students all experiences where they get the chance to create in the moment. And I don't know if we do that enough with our students. And particularly if we focus too early on notation, that can become problematic. Some people who don't read music at all can still be fluent, even in those genres of music that require notation. And even though it may take them a little bit longer, we sometimes act as though, well, if you can't read, then there's a whole cadre of music that's not open to you. And to the extent that there are some aspects of note reading that are important for music, and to the extent that, to some degree, for some types of music, note reading makes it more efficient to perform, I think it's important for us to realize that it doesn't necessarily have to stop people from engaging or performing it. And I don't know that we think about that as much as we should. Premature focus on music reading to the exclusion of the development of other facets of musicianship results in the devaluation of the ear, which Robert Woody characterizes as the musician's ultimate asset. After all, it is an oral art. And considering that oral transmission of music and playing by ear is the typical mode of music making across cultures and across centuries, and that is the way in which our initial engagement with music occurs, oral learning as a critical long-term component of learning in music takes on a greater significance. Here's what musicologist Peter Jeffrey has to say about the predilection we have for focusing on notation. So whether you agree with this statement or not, I think it's really important in terms of kind of giving us something to think about as we continue our respective journeys to become music educators. And so now I want to take you through a few activities that I think will maybe help to bring home some of these ideas about the significance of all music learning for the students that we teach and also for us as teachers. Some of the things we're going to ask you to do are things that I would have students do, and I might ask you about what things can be learned through them. And then other things we might do are things that I just want you to do to sort of interrogate your own capacities for oral learning. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the song Three to Get Ready by Dave Brubeck, but this piece shifts meter. And we're going to, it starts out basically in three. Some people might argue that it's 6/8, but I'm just going to say it's in three. And so what I want you to do is, you know, as you listen to it, when you feel that three pulse, just start doing this when you hear it. And it's not going to be very, initially it's not going to last very long. So you're going to have to kind of get into it fairly quickly. Here we go. Now I said it would shift. You're going to hear it again. It might start over. It might start where it is. I can never remember which. But when you hear it shift to four, instead of doing this, I would like for you to do this. Let's just do that one time together. Ready? And. Okay, you got it. Okay, so it's going to start in three, and then it's going to shift at some point. Stopping things in the middle. I tell my general music people, do not stop a piece of music in the middle of the phrase. Drives me nuts. So then on my computer, if I can't get the thing up soon enough and it went to the next phrase, I'm like, just let it play because I'm not going to stop it in the middle. Okay, so what could you learn? What could students learn from doing this particular activity? What are we helping them to do orally, you think? Yeah, this is the thing about the pattern to me is so crucial because it took all of you a little bit of time to figure out what, because there was a pattern to it, and fortunately in this example, it happens long enough for people to, if they just keep listening, they'll hear that it's two patterns of three and then two of four. But it took people a little bit of time. Some people got it right, almost right off the bat, but other people's like, what? And kids, this is the thing I like about this is that, you know, as teachers, we're often so quick to correct our students. I'll let them, if it takes them 20 minutes, I let them have that 20 minutes. Now, it's hard on the ones that get it the first time. But I do know that for the kids that work it out, they've got it. Not only that, but they feel or they sense that what they're doing corresponds to the meter that they're hearing. Because they know intuitively that if it's in four and they're still doing this, this doesn't really fit as well. And so for me, using the ear, not only to determine that there is a pattern, but also using your ear and your body to internalize that meter and how comfortable it feels when you're doing a motion that corresponds with the meter is really, really important. Because one of the things we try to do with students early on is develop that capacity to internalize steady beat. Because they can't do anything with meter unless they internalize steady beat. Because meter is a grouping of the beat, where the accents fall. If they can't feel that, they're not gonna feel this. And you might have some kids that are, they're not getting the steady beat yet. So a lot of if we're teaching conceptually, and I won't get into all the different ways we can present music to students, but when I was coming through, it was all about teaching about the elements of music and teaching conceptually. If we're focusing then on meter and music, this is a really great way to get them to feel it before we worry about whether they can tell me what the top number is, the bottom number is, and the meter signature. You know, to me, I don't care about that. Not with young children initially. Because that doesn't have any meaning for them unless they know this. If they don't know that, then the meter signature means nothing for them. Okay, I'm gonna take you to something new. You all know what an optical illusion is. How many of you see a young woman in this picture? How many of you see an old woman in this picture? Only a few. Take a minute. If you're a person who could not see the old woman, keep looking, and if you think you see him, raise your hand. Ah, some people can see me. And how many people can see the young woman? It's real interesting how this is always, everybody's always able to see the young woman better. Okay, this is, the young woman is not facing you, right? Her head is turned away. This is her cheek and jawline. That's an eyelash. That's part of her nose, part of her ear. She's got this weird thing on. I don't know what that is. The old woman, this is the old woman's eye, her nose. This is her mouth. Can you see the old woman now? Okay. Yeah, fine. Ooh, there it is. Now, I present this to you because we talk about oral perception. There are cultures that deal with rhythm in ways that result in what I call auditory illusions. That is, the perception of a rhythm can change depending on what the pulse, the underlying pulse is. I'm going to play a clave pattern. It's also often used in some Brazilian music, but it's often also used as a bell pattern in music of West Africa. And I'm going to ask you to do two different pulses on this. One pulse will make you hear the pattern one way, and the second pulse will make you hear the pattern slightly differently. I want you to keep your fingers crossed for me because the last time I did this, the demonstration didn't go the way I expected, but I'm hoping that it will this time, for me, in terms of what I had to do. So I'm gonna start it, and then I'm gonna ask you to clap one of them and then do the other on your feet. Okay, this one's for your feet. All right. Could you feel the pattern differently depending on the pulse that you were using? How many of you could? To me, that's an auditory illusion. Because the rhythm pattern did not change. But our relationship with it or how we perceived it changed based on the pulse. That's something that you can't get across necessarily as well visually as you can if you do it orally. Ordinarily, I would have people go back and forth between clapping it and patting it. We only have a certain amount of time to run it out. So, you know, that's one of the things that we can do with students where using our oral abilities, presenting these types of things to students orally is a big help to them as opposed to presenting it visually. And the last thing I probably have time to do with you is a song that I want to do with you to sort of involve you in ways that we can engage students in music making that involve improvisation or harmonization, or ability to harmonize. So I'm going to teach you a song. We're going to learn the melody first. And then we're going to do some different things to enhance it in terms of harmony and improvisation. The song's called Sylvie. It was written by Putty Ledbetter, blues musician better known as Leadbelly. It goes like this. Bring me little water, Sylvie. Bring me little water now. Bring me little water, Sylvie. Every little once in a while. And I'm going to tell you what I always tell my young children. Be my echo, please. Bring me little water, Sylvie.
Bring me little water, Sylvie.
Bring me little water now.
Bring me little water now.
Bring me little water, Sylvie.
Bring me little water, Sylvie.
Every little once in a while.
Every little once in a while.
Phrases at a time. Bring me little water, Sylvie. Bring me little water now.
Bring me little water, Sylvie. Bring me little water now.
Bring me little water, Sylvie. Every little once in a while.
Bring me little water, Sylvie.
Let's sing it all together. Ready? And
bring me little water, Sylvie. Bring me little water now. Bring me little water, Sylvie. Every little once in a while.
All right, now I want you to sing that again, and I'm going to do something specific in terms of how I improvise. And when we're done, I want you to share with me what you think I did. Ready and
bring me little water, Sylvie.
Sylvie.
Bring me little water now.
Bring it to me now.
Bring me little water, Sylvie.
Sylvie.
Every little once in a while.
What did I do? How did I decide to improvise? How would you describe what I did? Yes, ma'am. I filled up the blank spaces, which is typically what people who improvise do. Anytime there's this extended or sustained line, we're just not going to sing it out. We're going to fill it up with something. And how did I fill it up? In terms of text, what did I pull from? Yes?
The previous phrase.
The previous phrase. And also echoing at the end. Like, bring me little water, Sylvie, Sylvie. Made simple, right? These are things that young children can do if you help them. This time as we sing through, I would like for you to harmonize. Now you're my advanced choir, right? So you can do this. With another choir, I might go through a few other strategies to help them feel comfortable with that. But I also might have students in my classroom who sing, who do this all the time, but they don't get the opportunity, right? Because we're so score-centric, right? So here we go. Do you want to harmonize any way you want? Ready, and
Bring me a little water, still me. Bring me a little water.
Bring it to the night.
A simple song that really, in the version that I gave, is really just three different notes. Those are only three notes in that song. But you can do so much with it orally if you set it up in ways that students can engage. And you can enhance it, and it can feel really meaningful, and it can be lovely, right? And they're making music, right? But we haven't looked at a single score. So these are some of the ideas that come across when we talk about what would be the benefit of not looking at a score so much or not being so tied to a score. Again, I'm not saying we don't need to use, you know, a score in music. I'm saying we limit our ways of engaging with students, and we limit our ways of developing musicality if that's the only way we have children engage. I'm going to go really quickly because I only have a few minutes left, and there's something that, I don't want to miss out, you to miss out. It's just the last thing I want to share. Some of you may or may not know who this is. Anybody know who this person is? This is Libby Larson. And she's a contemporary composer. Libby tells a very telling story about her daughter's experience with oral learning in a band and how it affected her in terms of her participation in band. This is what she says. Talks about when her daughter was making a decision about an instrument. She said, finally, she, her daughter, decided on saxophone. When I brought one home, she told me to play When the Saints Go Marching In on the piano because she wanted me to accompany her. I was skeptical but sat down to play. She picked up the sax and played the song by ear perfectly. She joined the middle school band, spent the next year learning to play the B-flat scale and count eighth notes. And by the end of her second year of band, the music in her was so stifled by the pedagogy of the curriculum that she quit. I noticed that almost every other musically gifted child also quit. They already knew what music was. They knew what they knew when they joined the band how to make music and how it should feel. They learned that well in lower school, but they could not bear the unrelenting methodology that brought music to a standstill in their young lives. It made them sad and confused. They left music education to make music in other ways. And so I would like to challenge you to consider that too many students leave our music programs not only because the music they enjoy is not valued in those school music programs, but because their ways of learning and making music, and those ways are often orally based, are not valued, and they're not demonstrated in the class. And so I want to encourage all of you as you continue your journey to becoming music educators, that you consider the value of the ear and honor it in your teaching. And so I leave you with this. And I think we have time for questions. I wish we did, but thank you for your time.
You'll see them again on Friday.
Yeah, that's right, we'll see.